Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions and portfolios on this occasion is education and skills. So if any member wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I call question number one, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether young people have the opportunity to study subjects that they are interested in.
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Goruth.
Under Scotland's curriculum, pupils should be able to have appropriate personalisation and choice in both the broad general education and in the senior phase. Timetabling, staffing and resourcing issues may mean that's not always possible. Where a subject or course cannot be offered by the school, national guidelines encourage flexibility and collaboration with other local schools or colleges or through online and digital approaches.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware, of course, of concerns as far back as the OECD report and before, that subject choice in the senior phase has narrowed, and most worryingly, it's narrowed at a faster rate in schools in deprived areas. So when the Cabinet Secretary confirmed in response to Hayward that there would be, and I quote, a degree of rationalisation of the senior phase, people have grown concerned that the mistakes of the government that have led to a narrower curriculum could now become government policy. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what did she mean by a degree of rationalisation in the senior phase, and does she plan to further narrow subject choice?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raised this with me in the chamber when we talked to the government's response in relation to Professor Hayward's review. The first point I would make in relation to subject choice narrowing, and I know this has been an issue that Parliament debated in the previous session, is actually if you look at subject choice in the under curriculum for excellence, it's widened subject choice in terms of the broad general education because there are a wider range of subjects on offer to our young people until later in their academic year. However, what I think happened in the senior phase was the clash of culture between a senior phase dictated by a final exam system and a broad general education, which is about having these broad approaches to curricular areas. So we haven't managed to resolve that, and that, I think, was the point I was trying to convey in relation to Professor Hayward's response. On rationalisation, that was actually one of the key recommendations from Professor Hayward's response. And there are a number of subjects that are now being delivered in the school context we know that perhaps should be delivered elsewhere, perhaps in a college setting, for example. So when we talk about rationalisation, it's really about making sure the qualifications that are being delivered in our schools are appropriate for that environment. And I hope that gives the member some degree of comfort in terms of the government's approach here.
A couple of supplementaries. First, Claire Hawkey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out the breadth of subjects which are presently existing in Scottish education and what impact colleges, community campuses and virtual education have had on the provision available to pupils?
Cabinet Secretary.
I alluded to in my response to Pam Duncan-Glancy, Curriculum for Excellence provides pupils with a broad general education across 8 curricular areas. Schools and local authorities continue to improve access to different learning opportunities and a wider range of qualifications and courses in the senior phase through having those strong partnerships with colleges, community campuses and through virtual education. An excellent example of this collaborative approach is the delivery that we're seeing at Dunoon Grammar School, which was voted the best school in the world for community collaboration, which I visited earlier this year. In addition to the local online learning provision, the Scottish Government also funds the national e-learning offer and has also increased access to digital devices. And that collaborative approach to delivery has meant that since 2014, we've seen a sizeable increase in the number of vocational qualifications.
And Willie Rennie.
As the Education Secretary is cautious about the Hayward Review recommendations, what does it mean for parity of esteem between academic and vocational subjects, and what is she doing now to encourage a greater take-up of vocational opportunities in schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member for his question. He will be aware that in this year's exam results, we also saw another substantive increase in relation to the number of vocational and technical qualifications, which is to be welcomed, and which I also think shows again the strength of pathways that are now on offer in our schools. Of course, this work cuts across work that Mr Day is leading on in relation to post-school education reform, and we want to ensure that parity of esteem is reflected in the government's response, though, to Professor Hayward's report. Part of this is about education reform and is about reforming the very bodies I was in front of the Education Committee discussing yesterday. And I look forward to working with Mr Rennie on that to ensure that the reform of those bodies meets the aspiration around parity of esteem.
Question two, Sandish Gulhani.
Now, apologies, Presiding Officer and Chamber, for being late. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to support the university sector during the current academic year.
Minister Graham Day.
Officer, despite a challenging financial environment, we've continued to show our long-term commitment to Scotland universities by investing over £1 billion of teaching research grant funding in the sector in 2024-25, having done so in each year since 2012-13. Student support offering and policy on free tuition supports over 115,000 students this year, and SAS statistics show that the total amount of direct support to students is over £1 billion for the fifth year in a row. Ensuring our universities are on a sustainable trajectory is also at the heart of our ongoing work and engagement with the sector to reform the wider post-school education and school system so that the significant investment we are making delivers the best outcome for learners, the economy and society.
Sanders Gulhani.
I thank the Minister, but sustainability is not really going to cut it here, because the Education Institute for Scotland has voiced its concern over the fall in funding from Scottish Government for the Scottish university students. Funding is now 19% less in real terms per student than it was a decade ago. Savage funding cuts have caused an over-reliance on international students, whose numbers are now at record highs. And whilst I welcome international students, they should not be used to subsidise the lack of funding from this SNP government. A sudden decrease in their numbers for any reason could bankrupt our universities. Meanwhile, the SNP's cap on homegrown places for students means Scottish students are being turned away, of which I'm particularly concerned about medicine.
Question.
So, does the Cabinet Secretary consider that the over-reliance on income from international students is sustainable, and what consideration has he given to the far-reaching consequences
of allowing our
education system to be so bad?
Officer, it's nice to hear a Conservative welcoming international students, because the rhetoric of the last UK government was far from welcoming. I hope the university sector would agree that the Scottish Government is working very closely with it on a range of subjects to try and make it financially more sustainable. On the point about international students, we are working again very closely with them to try and enhance the numbers that are coming from a variety of countries. I don't believe that international students coming here is a bad thing. I recognise the risk that the member highlights, but I do just say to him gently that the issue around international student numbers dropping and the concern that that has caused is directly attributable to the actions and the rhetoric of the Westminster government, which he supported. And I seriously hope that this is a change of position from the Conservatives, certainly in this place, towards being more welcoming of international students and international staff, because that's where we should be as a country.
Question three, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what further support and guidance it can provide to secondary education establishments regarding the balance of rights to education of both a victim of sexual assault and an alleged perpetrator.
Cabinet Secretary.
There is no place for harassment or abuse of any form in our schools, and where staff have reason to believe a crime may have occurred, then they should follow school child protection procedures for onward reporting to Police Scotland and Social Work Services. In March this year, together with the former First Minister, I launched a new framework for preventing and responding to gender-based violence in our schools. And this framework is underpinned by the principle that all children and young people have the right to education, safety and justice, and that all children, young people and staff have the right to learn and work in an environment free from violence. The framework provides guidance for schools around how to respond to and support both a child or a young person who has experienced GBV and one who has allegedly carried out gender-based violence.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, and she will be aware, as am I, of research by Girl Guiding Scotland showing girls and indeed Glasgow University are too frequently experiencing inappropriate sexual behaviour or indeed assault. And I am, of course, aware of the good work going on in the Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group. But there still appears to be the need for specific consideration to ensuring victims are not isolated in learning hubs or other such-like places whilst repeat offendees can continue their school day as normal. And I've had a recent case in my caseload in my constituency of Falkirk East addressing this specific concern.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her interest in this issue. I'm aware of the research from Girl Guiding Scotland, which is seriously concerning, and I'm sorry to hear about the experiences of her constituent additionally. I think, as the GBV guidance makes very clear, the needs of the child or the young person who has experienced gender-based violence should be central in determining a response to support them, and that clear plan to secure the safety of all children and young people involved needs to be established by schools, including appropriate actions. I acknowledge, though, the member's concern about the burden of any change to learning environments falling on young people affected by sexual violence. I am, however, cognisant that schools should be given sufficient opportunity to implement the guidance, which, as I mentioned in my original answer, only published in March. The Government has, however, committed to commissioning an independent review of the guidance to establish positive practices and further areas for improvement before the end of this parliamentary session, and I'm happy to keep the member updated on the work of that review.
Thank you. Question 4 is not lodged. Question 5, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent report by Audit Scotland on Scotland's colleges, which states that, and I quote, "Colleges need more clarity from the Scottish Government on the aspects of their role to prioritise, and that colleges are, again a quote, making fundamental decisions about their future services without this clarity."
Minister Graham Day.
Then, officer, the Audit Scotland report recognises there are important opportunities coming from the work we are leading on post-school reform. As we progress that work, we are clear that the priorities for colleges include better alignment with local economic needs, close interaction with employers, and to be at the heart of skills planning in their regions. We are in an ongoing dialogue with the college sector in relation to these priorities, including through the work of the Tripartite Alignment Group, and we will continue to work with the colleges to support them to maximise their impact for the economy and communities.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for his answer. In the North East, Dundee and Angus College has recently launched its Sunrise Solutions project to embed climate awareness in its courses. Dundee can, of course, be a centre for decommissioning. North East Scotland College is due to open its Energy Transition Skills Hub, having already introduced net zero scholarships a couple of years ago. NESCOL clearly should play a key role in the just transition. Can the Minister outline what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure colleges have the strategic support and resources they need to help catalyse the transformations in our economy and society that we know are so desperately required?
Minister.
And also, colleges are critical to enabling the just transition to net zero, not only as centres of teaching and training, but also as key community anchors. I visited NESCOL last month during Scotland's Climate Week to celebrate their contribution to the North East and Scotland's energy sector, and whilst there was briefed on the Energy Transition Skills Hub that Maggie Chapman refers to. Like Dundee and Angus College, NESCOL is well led by a principal who is absolutely dialed into the needs of the local and wider economy, and in particular the just transition agenda. We are committed to doing all that we can, recognising the very challenging fiscal environment we're operating in, try and assist them in that work. We're working alongside colleges and the Scottish Funding Council to provide the strategic support that the member mentions, for example, via work progressing through the Tripartite Alignment Group, to provide greater flexibility for institutions in how they use the funding that is already available and the sharing of best practice.
Thank you. I've now got three, hopefully, brief supplementaries. First, Colin Beattie.
Can the Minister please set out what impact the enormous financial pressures caused by continuing UK Government austerity have had on funding available to support Scotland's college sector?
Minister.
So I've noted before, colleges do face budgetary challenges, and we cannot ignore the huge part austerity has played in that. And given the very difficult financial position we face as a government, I hope that Mr Beattie will recognise that the fact the Scottish Government budget for 24-25 provides colleges with the same resources as were available in 23-24 is a clear demonstration of this government's commitment to our colleges. As I said, we're working very closely with Colleges Scotland and the Funding Council via the Tripartite Group to put the resources at our disposal to best use, in line with individual college priorities and the needs of local economies. Of course, the unknown in all of this is whether the coming UK government budget will present further budgetary challenges for this government and our colleges.
And Liam Kerr.
Notwithstanding what we've just heard, the SFC published its final funding allocation in May 2024, and we saw the axing of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, no funding for digital poverty, mental health funding coming to an end. Now, in the context of a £32 million cut to the resource budget, an underlying deficit of £70 million, and four colleges with significant cash flow issues, is this government content to see a college fall over before it provides proper support and sustainable funding?
Minister.
This government, through the Scottish Funding Council, works incredibly closely with our colleges, and when identified issues come to the fore, they are responded to. But I'll say gently to Mr Kerr, who I have to say I'm disappointed to see leaving his role as education leader. I very much enjoyed our exchanges, but I do have to say to him gently, he lists all the issues that the college faces. Where is the self-awareness in all of this? Where is the recognition that at the heart of the problems that we all face is the actions of his former government in Westminster?
And Martin Whitfield.
Very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister's talked about the importance of the post-school aspect of colleges, but the Cabinet Secretary has just spoken regarding rationalisation, rightly raised the important role that colleges have in that. So can colleges prioritise their role in the senior phase, and how can they do that without investment from the Scottish Government?
Minister.
So the member, I'm sure, will be aware of these school-college partnerships which can be deployed in this space and are quite effectively deployed. And on the prioritisation, I'll get the word out, issue, I think he's absolutely right to highlight that. And that's one of the things we're looking at with the colleges, as to whether, if they want to choose to prioritise in that space, I want to give them the flexibility to do that.
Question six, Hamza Youssef.
To ask the Scottish Government to provide an update on its anti-racism in education programme.
Cabinet Secretary.
Delivering the work of the anti-racism in education programme is a key commitment in this year's programme for government. Working with the dedicated stakeholders who are key in driving forward the programme, I am pleased that progress is continuing to be made, including through the recent publication of the new anti-racist action guide developed to empower employers of teachers to better support their minority ethnic staff. There remains much to do, however, and the Scottish Government will continue to work with stakeholders and drive this important work forward.
Hamza Youssef.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that comprehensive response? The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that we are in Black History Month, and Scotland regrettably played a leading role in the British Empire, an empire that saw 3.1 million slaves forcibly transported from Africa to British colonies. Some of the wealthiest slave owners were, of course, Scottish, as, in fairness, were some of the leading abolitionists at the time. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that if we do not know our history, then we are undoubtedly doomed to repeat it? And therefore, will she provide me with an update on the efforts being made to ensure that our children are taught Scotland's history in relation to the British Empire?
Cabinet Secretary.
I very much agree with the member's sentiment, and particularly given that it's Black History Month, I think it is really important our history and our wider social studies curriculum provide a range of opportunities to teach about the British Empire, including Scotland's role in that. We're currently funding programmes of professional learning in relation to teaching slavery in Scotland and also migration and empire. Our anti-racism curriculum principles explicitly address the point that through the commitment that our children and young people will understand and inquire into Scotland's role in historical world events, which is hugely important. And that includes, of course, transatlantic slave enslavement and colonial histories and their continuing impact to this day. Education Scotland are also working with local councils to support the implementation of anti-racism curriculum principles.
Good question. Seven, Fergus Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on whether it will review any guidance in relation to the teaching of gender identity in schools in light of the CAS report.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that this guidance remains up to date and fit for purpose, and as with any significant legal or policy development, we will consider whether the guidance requires to be updated to reflect these. This will include any of the findings from the CAS review implications for Scotland report, which are relevant within a school's context.
Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, Dr. Hilary Cass said that social transition is not a neutral act, yet teachers with no experience in this area allow pupils to socially transition and indeed are encouraged to do so by the Supporting Transgender Young People in Schools guidance. Is it not morally wrong to teach our children that they could be born in the wrong body, and wrong that it's to teach them that it's possible to change one's sex? So why, despite the CAS findings, is the Scottish Government continuing to allow and indeed encourage gender ideology in schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the implications for Scotland report commissioned by the Chief Medical Officer set out the CAS review recommendations, which have been accepted, and they are relevant to gender identity healthcare improvement in NHS Scotland. It also recommends how such clinical services should be best delivered within NHS Scotland, and the report commissioned by the Chief Medical Officer report is now being acted on. But neither that report nor the CAS review itself examined or considered education settings, and I think that point is important. The CAS review's remit was to consider NHS England provided healthcare for children and young people seeking clinical support for their gender identity via NHS clinical services. So such services are not provided by schools or by school staff. I am very clear that it is not the role of schools or school staff to encourage or practically support a young person in their decision about their own gender identity. That is a matter for the young person and their families. Recognising the importance of ensuring our guidance to schools is up to date as possible. As I have indicated in my previous response, the guidance for schools will be updated to reflect any relevant changes and information in relation to gender identity services in Scotland as appropriate.
Two brief supplementaries. First, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. For many young LGBTQ plus people, home is not always a safe space where they can be themselves. A trusted teacher may be the only person available to confide in and turn to for advice and support. In a time of rising hostility and fear-mongering around the LGBTQ plus community, and in particular young trans people, can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government will ensure that young people who may be questioning their sexuality or gender identity are able to go to a trusted educational professional for support and information?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Emma Roddick raises a hugely important point, Presiding Officer, and I'm very clear that it is essential that all young people should be able to seek pastoral support from school staff, including advice. I also agree that there may be an increased need for such support given the current ongoing discourse within wider society in relation to LGBT young people and, of course, their rights. And that has become more challenging in recent years, which is exactly why it's so important that young people are able to have those relationships with those in their schools.
And Rose McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As already mentioned, Dr. Hilary Cass highlighted that social transitioning in classrooms was setting some children on a pathway to irreversible medical interventions. In addition, it's been widely reported that Scottish primary schools are appointing children as LGBT champions and asking pupils as young as four whether they're transgender. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm whether the Scottish Government will look into the role that taxpayer-funded organisations such as LGBT Youth Scotland play in teaching of gender identity in our schools?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think this issue in relation to LGBT Youth Scotland, who are not actually funded by the Education and Skills Portfolio, I should say, as an organisation, has already been discussed in the Chamber in recent months. But obviously we work with a variety of different third sector organisations, including LGBT Youth Scotland, to help shape policy and practice and to improve outcomes for LGBTQ plus communities. Funding is awarded to LGBT Youth Scotland through our Equality and Human Rights Fund. It delivers on a range of projects to support young people, and we are committed to working with organisations to support young people in terms of their education. I do think, though, going back to Ms Roddick's point, that this work has become much more important at a time when we are seeing a rise in attacks against the LGBTQ plus community. It is, of course, though, up to individual schools, colleges and universities to decide whether or not they want to undertake the LGBT Youth Scotland Charter for Education. But I would encourage the member to visit schools in her local area to see the impact of the Charter in practice.
And question 8, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what plans there are for the future of Gaelic education in primary schools in the Glasgow Annieslands constituency.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government supports Glasgow City Council to ensure primary Gaelic provision meets parental demand. Children in the Annieslands constituency currently access Gaelic primary education at Saul na Gaelic in Finiston. The Council is expanding primary provision across the city with the opening of a fourth GME primary in the Calton area. And through the Scottish Languages Bill, the Scottish Government is amending the Education Scotland Act 2016 to enhance the parental right to ask local authorities to assess the demand for Gaelic medium education within their community.
Okay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that. Now, Cabinet Secretary, we know that it's all over the place at the minute, but there are reports still that the UK Chancellor is planning to slash capital spending budgets by as much as a massive 10%, and that's alarmed a number of parents in my constituency concerned over the impact of such deep cuts would have in education, particularly in Gaelic. Can the Cabinet Secretary say how such proposed cuts would affect Scotland, and can she reassure my constituents of the Scottish Government's continuing commitment to supporting education in the face of continuing Labour austerity, and in particular to the provision and indeed expansion of Gaelic education?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government recognises the importance of capital funding, which, as members will know, over recent years has contributed to the growth of Gaelic medium education. And among other sources, such as Scottish Government funding for local authority projects and authorities' own allocations, the Gaelic Schools Capital Fund has been a really important source of funding for a range of different projects in Gaelic medium classes, schools and in community facilities additionally. The Gaelic Capital Fund was established back in 2008 and has been important for the continued growth of Gaelic education, for the language's revitalisation and for wider benefits to Scottish society. The Scottish Government's Gaelic Capital Fund has supported Glasgow City Council and other local authorities in decisions on the future of the Capital Fund will be made later this year, but I recognise the challenge the member makes in regard to decisions which are being taken elsewhere, which are ultimately impacting on decisions being taken by this government, particularly in relation to capital decisions.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on education and skills. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item to allow front benches to change.